Mari bergabung dalam ibadah doa dan puasa setiap hari Sabtu pukul 10 pagi melalui Zoom link berikut ini. www.bcs.org.sg/zoom/satprayer. Bethany Church Singapura mengundang setiap jemaat untuk bergabung di dalam ibadah malam Natal The Messiah. Pada hari Kamis 24 Desember 2020 jam 7.30 malam waktu Singapura melalui Zoom link www.bcs.org.sg/zoom/christmas dan via live streaming YouTube channel Bethany Church Singapura. Kami menghimbau Bapak Ibu Saudara sekalian untuk mengenakan pakaian berwarna hijau atau merah dan mempersiapkan lilin untuk prosesi Christmas Candlelight. Dan pada hari Jumat 25 Desember 2020, ibadah Natal lahirnya Yesus Sang Mesias bersama Pastor Niko Nyoto Raharjo akan dimulai dari jam 8.30 pagi waktu Singapura melalui YouTube channel Bethany Church Singapura. Untuk keterangan lebih lanjut, saudara bisa lihat di e-flyer pada akun Instagram dan Facebook Bethany Church Singapura. I'm coming home for Christmas Day. Sorry that I've been so far away, but there is no time or distance that can come in between us. I'm coming home for Christmas Day. I know that I'll be just a little late. I'm sorry that you had to wait, but baby, I'm on my way to make it home for Christmas Day. Nothing will ever change. The reason we celebrate. I'm coming home for Christmas Day. I'm sorry.
Saudara dapat memberikan persembahan atau perpuluhan secara online melalui fitur PayNow berikut ini.
Shalom jemaat Tuhan. Selamat bergabung kembali bersama kami di ibadah online Bethany Church Singapura. Kami senang menyambut Bapak Ibu, saudara sekalian yang selalu setia beribadah bersama kami. Tidak terasa kita sudah berada di minggu terakhir di bulan November dan segera kita akan memasuki bulan terakhir di tahun 2020 ini. Mari, setiap hari, setiap saat, penuhi hidup kita dengan ucapan syukur atas kasih, kebaikan, kemurahan, pemeliharaan, dan perlindungannya dalam hidup kita semua. Haleluya! Sebelum kita memulai ibadah kita hari ini, mari kita satukan hati dan berdoa. Bapa, kami mengucap syukur buat kasih-Mu yang melimpah dalam hidup kami. Sebentar kami akan memulai ibadah pada hari ini, biarlah Tuhan yang hadir menjamah, mengurapi, membuka hati kami untuk masuk dalam pujian dan penyembahan. Biarlah segala pujian, kehormatan, keagungan hanya bagi nama-Mu Tuhan. Terima kasih Tuhan Yesus, hanya di dalam nama Tuhan kami berdoa dan mengucap syukur. Haleluya. Amin. Mari kita masuk dalam pujian dan penyembahan. Selamat beribadah.
Dalam segala kelimpahan, Saat ini mari sama-sama kita memuji Tuhan. katakan sama-sama.
Ku masuki gerbangnya Tuhan dengan hati yang bersyukur. Ku bersorak memuji Tuhan, dialah sukacitaku. Sebab dia baik, dia sungguh baik, kasih setianya untuk selamanya. Sebab dia baik, dia sungguh baik, kasih setianya.
Sama-sama saudara,
kasih setianya untuk selamanya. Sebab dia baik, dia sungguh baik, kasih setianya kekal. Sebab dia baik, kasih setianya untuk selamanya. Sebab dia baik, dia sungguh baik, kasih setianya kekal. Sebab dia baik, dia sungguh baik, kasih setianya untuk selamanya. Sebab dia baik, dia sungguh baik, kasih setianya kekal, kasih setianya kekal, kasih setianya kekal selamanya.
Terima kasih Tuhan, Kau sungguh baik dalam hidup kami. Yang percaya sama-sama katakan haleluya. Haleluya.
Terima kasih Yesus. Terima kasih Yesus, ku bersyukur hanya bagimu, ya Allahku, ya Tuhanku. Terima kasih Yesus, terima kasih Yesus. Bersyukur hanya bagimu, terima kasih Yesus.
Sebab kami tahu rancanganmu yang mendatangkan kebaikan. Apapun yang terjadi, ini nyanyian kami Tuhan.
Yang dulu tak ku mengerti, sekarang Kau buat mengerti. Singkapkan engkau dalam hidupku.
Mari katakan,
terima kasih Yesus. Terima kasih Yesus. Ku bersyukur hanya bagimu, ya Allahku, ya Tuhanku. Terima kasih Yesus.
Terima kasih.
Saudara, pernahkah kita berpikir bagaimana banyak hamba-hamba Tuhan atau orang-orang percaya dipakai dengan karunia kesembuhan ilahi, mengusir setan, membangkitkan orang mati, bahkan melakukan hal-hal yang luar biasa? Misalnya di dalam Alkitab, Musa, Paulus, Petrus, dan banyak tokoh iman lainnya melakukan hal-hal yang luar biasa. Ada satu kesamaan dari semua tokoh-tokoh tersebut, yaitu pengurapan Tuhan yang luar biasa ada pada mereka. Sesungguhnya pengurapan dari Tuhan adalah penting bagi orang percaya. Dalam edisi Voice of Pentecost kali ini,
kita akan membahas mengenai pengurapan dalam pelayanan dan kehidupan orang percaya. Di dalam Perjanjian Lama, tindakan pengurapan dilaksanakan pada acara ritual keagamaan, seperti penahabisan imam besar, penahabisan imam yang melayani, pengangkatan seorang raja, serta pengangkatan seorang nabi. Di dalam Perjanjian Lama, memang hanya orang-orang yang khususlah yang dapat menerima pengurapan. Sedangkan dalam Perjanjian Baru, pengurapan diberikan kepada orang-orang yang percaya kepada Yesus Kristus. Dalam Perjanjian Lama, instrumen yang seringkali dipakai dalam pengurapan adalah minyak. Minyak adalah lambang persetujuan dengan Allah, kehadiran Allah, berkat, kuasa, penghiburan, kesembuhan, sukacita, perkenanan, dan kesejahteraan. Akan tetapi, dalam Perjanjian Baru tidak terlalu ditekankan tentang minyak, tetapi Roh Kudus menjadi instrumen pengurapan itu sendiri. Prinsip yang mendasari pengurapan minyak adalah prinsip konsekrasi, yaitu memisahkan atau mengkhususkan sesuatu atau seseorang kepada Tuhan. Prinsip konsekrasi dengan pengolesan minyak tetap berlaku pada era Perjanjian Baru. Lalu, apa contoh peristiwa pengurapan dalam Alkitab? Salah satunya adalah pengurapan double portion. Pengurapan dua kali ganda sangat dikenal dalam gereja aliran Pentakosta dan karismatik. Istilah ini mengacu kepada peristiwa Elia dan Elisa yang dicatat dalam 2 Raja-Raja 2 ayat 1-14, di mana Elisa meminta 2 bagian dari roh Elia. Salah satu dampak dari pengurapan double portion yang diterima Elisa adalah mujizat-mujizat yang Tuhan kerjakan melalui pelayanan Elisa 2 kali lipat lebih banyak dari Elia. Hal ini tidak membuktikan bahwa Elisa lebih hebat dari Elia, justru lebih membuktikan bagaimana mentoring yang dilakukan Elia kepada Elisa berhasil. Peristiwa yang senada juga terjadi pada zaman Perjanjian Baru, di mana Tuhan Yesus menyampaikan kepada murid-muridnya dalam Yohanes 14 ayat 12, "Sesungguhnya barang siapa percaya kepadaku, ia akan melakukan juga pekerjaan-pekerjaan yang aku lakukan, bahkan pekerjaan-pekerjaan yang lebih besar daripada itu." Maksud perkataan Tuhan Yesus bukan berarti orang percaya lebih hebat darinya, melainkan orang percaya akan melakukan pelayanan yang menjangkau lebih banyak orang, serta pelayanan kepada bangsa-bangsa non-Yahudi. Dengan perkembangan teknologi, internet, dan media sosial, kini semua pelayanan penjangkauan dimungkinkan. Roh Kudus memenuhi dan mengurapi orang percaya untuk melakukan pelayanan tersebut. Pengurapan double portion merupakan pengurapan untuk pelayanan yang lebih besar. Umumnya terjadi dalam konteks bapa rohani dengan anak rohani. Orang percaya yang merindukan pengurapan tersebut tentu harus membangun hubungan bapa-anak dengan pemimpin rohani yang Tuhan Yesus tempatkan di atasnya. Selanjutnya, apa maksud dan tujuan dari pengurapan? Dalam Lukas 4 ayat 18-19 dijelaskan bahwa Yesus Kristus sebagai yang diurapi. Jikalau Yesus saja menerima pengurapan dari Allah, terlebih lagi kita sebagai orang percaya. Oleh karena itu, pengurapan harus disadari sebagai bagian dari perjalanan orang percaya dalam menjalankan panggilan Kristus. Dalam hidup setiap hari, Tuhan pun telah berkata bahwa Ia sebagai gembala yang baik akan mengurapi kepala orang percaya dengan minyak. Pengurapan yang diberikan kepada orang-orang percaya dalam era Perjanjian Baru bukanlah untuk tujuan keselamatan atau berkat secara jasmani, namun untuk tujuan pelayanan, yaitu pemberitaan Injil dan menyatakan kuasa Allah. Dan yang terakhir, pengurapan merupakan bagian tidak terpisahkan dari hidup orang percaya. Salah satu yang membedakan antara orang percaya dengan orang yang belum percaya adalah adanya pengurapan Tuhan dalam hidupnya. Sebagai pengikut Kristus, pengurapan bukanlah sesuatu yang asing, melainkan menjadi bagian yang penting dalam perjalanan iman dan keseharian kita. Dengan demikian, orang yang percaya kepada Kristus sudah seharusnya menjadikan pengurapan sebagai bagian yang penting dan tidak terpisahkan dari hidup mereka. Sekarang adalah era Pentakosta yang ketiga, di mana orang percaya menjadi the messenger of the third Pentecost. Dan pengurapan sungguh sangat kita perlukan untuk menuntaskan amanat agungnya. Misi kerajaannya tidak dapat dilakukan dengan kekuatan kita sendiri. Jadi, kita jangan sampai melewatkan kesempatan untuk menerima pengurapan dari Tuhan melalui para pemimpin rohani kita. Mari terima pengurapan Tuhan dengan iman dan mulai melangkah untuk mengerjakan apa yang Roh Kudus perintahkan di dalam hidup kita. Tuhan Yesus memberkati.
Mazmur 91. Dalam lindungan Allah. Orang yang duduk dalam lindungan yang maha tinggi dan bermalam dalam naungan yang maha kuasa akan berkata kepada Tuhan, tempat perlindunganku dan kubu pertahananku, Allahku yang kupercayai. Sungguh, Dialah yang akan melepaskan engkau dari jerat penangkap burung, dari penyakit sampar yang busuk. Dengan kepaknya Ia akan menudungi engkau. Di bawah sayapnya engkau akan berlindung. Kesetiaannya ialah perisai dan pagar tembok. Engkau tak usah takut terhadap kedahsyatan malam, terhadap panah yang terbang di waktu siang, terhadap penyakit sampar yang berjalan di dalam gelap, terhadap penyakit menular yang mengamuk di waktu petang. Walau 1000 orang rebah di sisimu dan 10.000 di sebelah kananmu, tetapi itu tidak akan menimpamu. Engkau hanya menontonnya dengan matamu sendiri dan melihat pembalasan terhadap orang-orang fasik. Sebab Tuhan ialah tempat perlindunganmu, yang maha tinggi telah kau buat tempat perteduhanmu. Malapetaka tidak akan menimpa kamu, dan tulah tidak akan mendekat kepada kemahmu. Sebab malaikat-malaikatnya akan diperintahkannya kepadamu untuk menjaga engkau di segala jalanmu. Mereka akan menatang engkau di atas tangannya, supaya kakimu jangan terantuk kepada batu. Singa dan ular tedung akan kau langkahi. Engkau akan menginjak anak singa dan ular naga. Sungguh, hatinya melekat kepadaku, maka aku akan meluputkannya. Aku akan membentenginya, sebab ia mengenal namaku. Bila ia berseru kepadaku, aku akan menjawab. Aku akan menyertai dia dalam kesesakan. Aku akan meluputkannya dan memuliakannya. Dengan panjang umur akan kukenyangkan dia, dan akan kuperlihatkan kepadanya keselamatan daripadaku.
Mari kita terus berdoa untuk Pentakosta ketiga. 1. Pentakosta ketiga adalah pencurahan Roh Kudus yang dahsyat di zaman ini, melebihi yang terjadi di Azusa Street. Pentakosta ketiga akan mengakibatkan penuaian jiwa yang terbesar dan yang terakhir sebelum Tuhan Yesus datang kembali. 3. Pentakosta ketiga akan membangkitkan generasi Yeremia, yaitu anak-anak muda yang dipenuhi Roh Kudus, cinta mati-matian kepada Tuhan Yesus, tidak kompromi terhadap dosa dan akan bergerak untuk memenangkan jiwa. 4. Pentakosta ketiga lahir di Indonesia dan bergerak ke bangsa-bangsa. Gerakan ini dari timur ke barat dan akan kembali ke Yerusalem. 5. Pentakosta ketiga akan memberikan kuasa untuk menyelesaikan amanat agung, dan setelah itu Tuhan Yesus datang kembali. Amin, amin, amin. Haleluya.
Ada tertulis dalam firman Tuhan, dalam Lukas 1 ayat 37 dikatakan, sebab bagi Allah tidak ada perkara yang mustahil. Dimanapun saudara berada, dimanapun saudara berdiri saat ini, percayalah bahwa Dia, Tuhan Yesus, sanggup melakukan perkara yang besar. Amin, saudara. Panggil Dia Yesus Tuhan. Haleluya.
Yesus Tuhan, mulialah namanya. Yesus Allahku, besar kasihnya. Dahulu, sekarang, dan sampai selamanya, kasihnya tak pernah berubah. Yesus Tuhan, mulialah namanya. Yesus Allahku, besar kuasanya. Dahulu, sekarang, sampai selamanya, kuasanya tak pernah berubah. Dia sanggup, Yesus sanggup melakukan perkara yang besar. Dia sanggup, Yesus sanggup yang menderita. Dia sanggup memulihkan hidupku.
Hi. Today we want to talk about how we can live by example. Well, it's never easy, especially when we are on the stage all the time. Whether you are speaking, singing, or performing, it doesn't matter. As long as you step out of the house, guess what? We are on the stage. People will be judging us, looking at us, criticizing us all the time, especially when people know that we are Christians. And so the things that we say, the things that we do, they will judge us a bit more harshly because as Christians, you ought to be behaving better. As Christians, you sure you say that? As Christians, you eat that? As Christians, you know, you do that? So, you know, it's hard to live by example. But this is what Jesus said in John chapter 13. I have given you an example that you also should do as I have done to you. These are the words of Jesus. That God has given us an example of how we should live. And He is the leading example that we should also do just as God has done to us. And so just God has come into us, and through us, we will set example. We lead by example for others to follow. First Peter says, to this you were called because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in His steps. So it is without doubt that as Christians, we cannot just simply live our own and talk anything that we want and, you know, and argue with everybody that we think is unfair to us and all that. Remember, we are being watched all the time. And people will look at us and say, "Ayo, Christian like that one, how to follow? How to, you know, why go to church? You know, he's no different from the non-believers." But remember, Christ has set an example for us how to live, and therefore we need to live by that example. And so whether we like it or not, as Christians, there should be a transformation from inside out, because the Bible says those who were in Christ become a new creature. So as a new creature, as a new person, as being transformed, you know, we shouldn't behave the way we were prior before becoming a Christian. There must be some newness, some changes, some ways that people could see that there's a difference about this. There's something different about this person. There's something unique about this person that I like and I want to follow. It is not easy, because you have to be conscious all the time. So it's not easy to live by the example. I know we all, especially, you know, speaker, pastors, people who are in the public sphere of things, you know, it's not easy because you have been observed, scrutinized more harshly because you're up there on the stage. And even though, as I mentioned earlier, even though we may not be on the stage, as long as we tell people that we are Christian, all of a sudden their antenna will shoot up and they will think, "Oh, Christian, okay, Christian, Christian." Oh, then, you know, the way you speak, you know, in your mind, Christian like that, is Jesus like that? Is Jesus okay with this and all that? And so we are being judged more harshly as Christians. Always remember that. I know it is not easy. And some people ask, how to start? How do I start? You know, where do I start? How do I know I need to do certain things and all that? Well, I have a suggestion for you. Perhaps we can start by learning how to behave the way Christ has taught us. You know, one of the most important lessons that Jesus taught was in the mount, was in the mountain. And there He taught the Beatitudes. See, Jesus was challenging the Sadducees, the Pharisees, the priests of the days, because they were called priests, they were called, you know, the Sadducees and the Pharisees, and they are the one who hate the temple, but they are not behaving the way they should be behaving. They were corrupted, and they were also doing things that is not healthy as a priest. And then Jesus have to contend with them. And so when He went up to the mountain, thousands of people, including His disciples, followed Him to the mountain. There He sat down and He taught them that these should be your behaviors. If you want to change, if you want to see as someone who is new and being transformed, perhaps these are the behaviors that we need to adopt. These are the behaviors that we need to set in ourselves so that we can then set that as an example for others. So in that way, we live by example. And now let me reiterate, one of the most important lessons that Jesus taught was this lesson found in Matthew chapter 5. We call it the Beatitudes. Everything about our transformation and the lifestyle comes under this Beatitudes. You see, we judge the tree and the fruit by its roots. If the tree is healthy, it's strong, that means the root is healthy. And when Jesus taught the Beatitudes, he actually started with the root and then he went up to the trunk and then went up to the fruit, because these are the fruit of how you should be exhibiting and how people should see that in you as a new transformed life in Christ Jesus. So every attitude, there's seven attitudes there, but every one of them built upon each other. They are not random separated attitudes that, you know, Jesus just plucked something from the air and then tell you to it, and then he taught. Everything, you know, built on each other. You want this, you can, you, if you need this, to have this attribute, you need to have this attribute, because this attribute will build upon this. So let's learn from Jesus how we should be behaving, and so that we can live by example. And the first thing he taught was that blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. It's so important that we need to be poor in spirit, because if we want to be part of the kingdom of heaven, this is something that we must first surrender. There's a human spirit, there's a godly spirit. So if our human spirit surrendered that to God's spirit, then we join God in the kingdom of heaven. But if it's all about our own spirit, it's by ourselves, then we drive God out of our lives. And so we behave the way we want to behave and not how the kingdom of heaven would like us to behave. Why is this important? Well, in 1 Thessalonians, I'm sorry about this verse, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23, not 1 Peter, yeah, I'm sorry, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23, Paul says, may your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Again, this verse is found in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23. I apologize for this. Paul was saying that, may your whole spirit, soul, and body, and therefore all of us are created to be tripart being. Your body can be in church, but your spirit and your soul is not right. It is not holistic. So your whole, everything in you have to surrender to God. It's just because you don't go to certain places that will cause you to sin, that doesn't mean that you're not sinning. You have to be surrendering your spirit and your soul and your body. And this is a sequence. Spirit first, soul, and then body. But Hollywood changed the holy word, right? In the sequence, Hollywood changed that to body first. Pay attention to your body, buy all these clothes, drive all these fancy cars and all that. Then you will see somebody in the socioeconomic status of your country or whatever, wherever that you are. But the sequence of the holy word is your spirit first, your soul, and your body. Don't change that. That's Hollywood change. Right? Your spirit first. That's why he says, blessed are the poor in spirit. So we all tripart being. We have our body. If you are alive today, you should have a body. If you are dead and you have a body and you're listening to this, something is not right. Okay. Your body, when you die, will go back to dust. Okay. The Greek word for body is soma. And so if you have somatic problem, that means you have a body, physical problem. Then you have a soul. The soul, the Greek word for soul is psyche. This is where the word psychology comes from. This is where your mind and your emotions are parked at. And then you have a spirit, pneuma. Greek word for spirit is pneuma. Pneuma means air, like pneumatic drill, pneumatic palm, and all that. Pneuma means air. You see, God breathed into human. God breathed into Adam, but God did not breathe into Brya. He did not breathe into crocodiles or lions and all that. He only breathed into man. And we have this third part in us. It's so critical. But, you know, in our body, we have the five senses. This is where our antennas are. You know, we see, what we see, what we hear, what we smell, what we touch, what we taste will first go into our soul. This is our processing area here. We process everything that we see and hear and touch and all that in our, you know, outside of our environment, and it processes here. And if we hear something that is nasty, we don't like it, then it activates our soul. Our soul is not activated, and we are angry, and we cannot forgive the person for saying certain things about us, then our soul will overwhelm our entire body. And so the people around us will know that we are upset because our soul will overwhelm. It takes control. We are angry. You know, we are upset. And then we feel resentful. We feel bitter about this. And then these transport the feeling that's inside us will then transport it to our body. We shut down. We shut down our five senses. We no longer want to eat, no longer want to see and hear and touch and all that. We shut down. So everything becomes internalized. We are angry. Don't talk to me about this. Don't talk to me about that. And then as a result of this, our world is darkened because we are behaving in a very soulish manner. Not spiritual, but soulish, very soulish, because we allow our soul to dictate us. And this is where people will say that you're Christian, and you get angry like that, you talk things like that, you're so upset, you're so bitter and all that. No, this is because we may be Christians, but our soul is in control, not the Spirit of God that's in control of us. Remember, God breathed into Adam. God did not breathe into warriors or lions or animals. And sometimes, because our soul governs us, we think that the soul now become our spirit. We control ourselves. We are the one in control. Yes, I want that person to pay back what he did to me. And so that becomes the spirit. We confuse the soul with our spirit and thinking that that is the determinant of our life. You know, then we are no different from animals. Yeah? Remember, God only breathed to man, right? Animals got no spirit. They have no spirit. They have body. They have the senses. And in fact, their senses are stronger than humans. But they also have emotions. They have a soul. And they can get upset. Like dogs will you know, no matter what you do to them, sometimes, you know, the puppy dies, the mother dog will, you know, be upset and all that. This is the soul that's been triggered, but they have no spirit. They have no spirit because God did not break into them. So if we get angry, we get our soul is triggered, and then we become resentful, we become bitter, and we assume that this is our spirit, we're going to do this. And therefore, it, you know, it channels into our interaction with our environment. And then people said, I see no difference between you and those who are not Christian. In fact, sometimes the non-Christian behave better than you as a Christian. That's because we allow our soul to dictate our spirit. And then as a result of this, we behave in manners that's not being transformed. You know, God says, blessed are the poor in spirit. So right now, if your soul is in charge and you think that your soul is now your spirit, you can become emotional. Sometimes we confuse anointing with emotions. Oh, the song is good, our handstand and our emotions get into the way. It may not be, it may be our emotions that's reacting. So we have to be very careful with that. Yeah. And so when that is happening, then who is in charge? So in every quarrel, right, in every conflict that we are involved in, it's the soul that is driving that interaction in that conflict. Who is in charge? Is God's spirit in charge of us, or is our own soul in charge of our lives? Blessed are the poor in spirit, meaning we need to, you know, surrender our soul and go out to the Spirit of God. This is what David said. David said, why am I so downcast, O my soul? And he did not go into a resentment. He did not go into bitterness. And he go out to the Spirit and he began to say, why am I so downcast, O my soul? Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not his benefit. He lifted up his soul into the Spirit of God. He surrendered this to God. And the Spirit is open and God began to minister to him. And when God ministered to him, everything is open, and the peace of God that transcends all understanding, which is here in the soul, the peace of God that comes from God, the peace that comes from God that transcends or understanding. That means it will bypass your soul. It will come upon you and you experience the peace of God. When you experience the peace of God, now you're able to open. You're able to open to opinions of what people say, and you're able to enjoy your life because God is in control. When God is in control, everything lightens and brightens up once again. And therefore, when we act this way, we are spiritual. We are different from others. You know, people can set us, but God's spirit is in us. We remain cool. We remain calm, you know, and we are able to deal with the conflict. We are not given to impulsion and impatience and all that because we are now behaving spiritually. So when something happens, it goes to your soul. Remember, surrender this to God and make your spirit, you know, poor and make God's spirit strong so that, you know, you act spiritually rather than soulishly. As I mentioned earlier, sometimes we confuse our soul with our spirit, but it is our spirit. God breathed into us. We have a spirit. And Jesus told that woman and the well, you worship God in spirit. You know, it's your human spirit. You worship God. We surrender this to God and let God's spirit come and take control and spirit and in truth. And so sometimes our soul, our mind lie to us that we are bad. The person is bad. No, we worship God in spirit and in truth. And in the word also say that the truth will set us free. So it's so important that Jesus started with this. It's because this is your root system. If your root system is bad, your fruit will be bad. Because if your root is emotions that is unresolved, that bitterness and all that, then your fruit will not be sweet for others to taste. And so good fruit must have good root. The stronger the root, the better the tree, the better the fruit. And right in the fruit is this idea called well, in spirit. You got to start this. You got to surrender your life. That's how you live by example. That's how God lived, showed us. He set an example. We must live the example because God surrendered everything in the spirit to his Father. And then he also said, blessed are they who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are those who mourn. That's, he doesn't mean about, you know, the death of a person that you're going grieve. He says, if you have a pain in your root system, if you have someone who's upset you, you know what? You know, you need to mourn and confess it to Jesus and give it to God. You know, learn to forgive, you know, and God will comfort you. The comfort that we receive from God is different from what we think comfort is. You see, the word comfort means to come alongside and fortify us. Coming alongside to fortify us, to strengthen us, to, you know, to make us stronger. And if we are weak, surrender to God, you know, confess that to God, you know, and say that I'm weak. Then when we are able to confess that to God, then we will be comforted. Comforted means God will come alongside us and strengthen us. Fortification, that means it fortify us. That's the word fort here. Remember this, if we don't surrender this to God, if we continue to bear, this is my right, this is me and all that, if we don't mourn about our past, about what happened to us, what people did to us, we don't surrender to God, we will remain in this. When we surrender, when we forgive and let God comfort us, things will change. We are now free from our past. We can live with freedom and with joy, you know, and with liberty. Under the confine of what it meant to be the kingdom of God. See, the tree, remember, good tree must have good roots. And so in your root system, it must have been poor in spirit and also to be able to mourn, to surrender it to God rather than to deal with it, you know, to pay back what people what did to me, you know, make sure that they know my pain. No, surrender and mourn it and give it to God, and God will comfort us. There's a lot of difference when we give our pain to God compared to when we try to do it on our own. This becomes our root system, right? To be poor in spirit, surrendering our life and our soul and our emotions and our spirit to God, and also surrendering our pain, our emotional pain, and what people did to us, you know, to God. Then, with this two root system, then the first characteristics of a Christian is that they must be meek. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. You see, when you are poor in spirit, you become part of the kingdom of heaven. And when you are meek, you inherit the earth. This is the blessing here. But you cannot be meek. You cannot be meek. One cannot be meek unless they surrender their life to God. they surrender their pain to God. Otherwise, it's all about me. I'm proud. I'm defensive. I'm offensive and all that. So if you are still proud and you're still offensive and defensive about who you are, you will not be inheriting the earth because you are not meek. And you're not meek because you're not poor in spirit. You're not mournful. You're not surrendering your pain and yourself to God. See, to be meek is to be humble. That means you have strength, you have power, but it's under control. You don't have to tell people that you are powerful. You don't have to tell people that you are strong, you are number one, you are better than anybody else. You don't have to be combative. You don't have to be competitive because, hey, God is in charge. I have the power of the Holy Spirit. You know, God did not give us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power, love, and a sound mind. I don't need to fight all the time because God will fight for me. I don't need to pay back what people does for me because God has comforted me. So if you are proud, people say maybe some opinions about you is that people are saying that you're proud and you are highly offensive and defensive, maybe because the root system is not corrected yet. So if you want to change your life and then, you know, show a good example, and just as Jesus has done for us, change this verse. Surrender your spirit to God. Mourn about your pain. Give it to God and forgive. And be humble. We cannot be humble if we are defensive and we are open to attack anyone who offended us. So this then becomes the third thing, the third attribute of the Beatitudes. You cannot be meek if you're poor, if you're not poor in spirit, if you're not mournful. Because if God is not comforting you, if God is not in control of your spirit, then you are not able to be humble. To be humble is to know that God is in charge. Everything belongs to God. Everything that I do is a blessing from God. You know, it's because God loves me so much that I have all this. But if you're not meek, if someone could be saying, I did it by myself, I work hard, it's all about me, it's not God. And so that's why sometimes, you know, people look at us and say, yeah, this person is proud. But we want people to say that, wow, this person is humble. In spite of what he has, in spite of the success that he has, he attributes everything to God. He's very humble. He never even say anything about himself. That's how we live by example, right? Then the next attribute is righteousness. Hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. You know what? If you are not humble, you cannot handle righteousness, what is right. Because if you're not humble, you will be criticizing others because I am right, you are wrong. This is you, you're bad, you are wrong, and all that. And so we cannot handle judgment with righteousness if we're not meek. So righteousness becomes a point of judging others that I am right, you are wrong. And when we are unable to manage righteousness, it's because we are not meek. And we are not meek because we are not poor in spirit and we are not mournful about our own pain and allowing God to strengthen us, to bless us. Hunger and thirst for righteousness. Are you hungering and thirsting for righteousness? That's the key here, right? Righteousness is something that's out there, but are you hungering and thirsting for it? Because if you're not hungry and thirsting for righteousness, if you are just wanting to know, to feel your own satisfaction, well, then your righteousness is a bit more, the way you see righteousness is perhaps a bit more subjective. If you're not hungry, if you're not thirsty for righteousness, then something is not right about our spiritual life. Just like if you're not hungry and thirsty for physical food, then perhaps you have been, I have been eating too much of this, you know, junk. They call it junk food or fast food, right? All we snack, potato chips, you know, French fries and Coca-Cola and all that. Maybe we have been eating junk food and therefore we have no appetite for the real food. Maybe all this while we have been, you know, thinking junk food, junk here, you know, thinking rich to stinking living. We feed all the junk, comes out all the junk. In all the garbage, we fed out, we come out all the garbage. And we are not hungry and thirsty for God's righteousness, what he meant to be righteous. We just being full of ourselves. So when you're not hungry, it could be that we are fed with too much junk food. Or maybe that's why the world is darkened when you're not hungry for the righteousness of God. And maybe we're not hungry because we're going through a lot of emotional pain. You know, when you when the person is psychologically disturbed, you know, they go through a breakup, a marriage broken down, relationship is separated and all that, you go through the stress and all that. When you're going through that stress, you have no mood to eat. You lost that appetite. And then anything that you people say to you, it doesn't seem right. And so you're not hungry and thirsting for food, just as you're no longer hungry and thirsting for God's righteousness. So you're so full of yourself here, perhaps because you're so anxious, it's rightly so, but we need to humble ourselves, you know, be meek, and then, you know, surrender the pain that we have to God. Let Him comfort us. And then, but, you know, firstly, we need to be pure in spirit, surrender our lives, our spirit to God. See, when we are upset, when we are fed with all this junk food, who is right? You know, because we all need to be fed with the word of God that gives out righteousness. But we cannot handle righteousness, the word of God, if we're not meek. Otherwise, we handle righteousness like, you know, I know better than you. I am better than you. I am more intelligent than you. I know more of the word of God than you. You don't know anything. And so we handle righteousness without meekness. That's because there's no mournfulness about our own soul and our spirit here. So when these two are not in the root system, then we are not meek. When we are not meek, it's harder to handle righteousness. You know, we handle with pride or with bitterness. You are right, man. You are right. You are right. What makes you right? You know, you are always like this. So we judge others because we feel that, you know, we are bitter or we are proud of ourselves. We are defensive. I think nobody likes to hang around someone who is proud, bitter, and very judgmental. So if you want to be living by example, make sure that even if you know what is right, you handle it properly. Handle it wisely. Handle it humbly. And so, you know, if you handle righteousness correctly, it's because perhaps you have learned to be humble yourself. You have learned to be meek. You don't have to show people you're strong all the time. You're meek. You're meek because you're mournful about your soul and the pain. You allow God to minister to you, for He shall comfort you here. And then as you surrender your spirit to God, allow God's spirit to be the one in control. So when you have this as your root system, then your basic characteristics of a Christian is to be humble. And then whatever that you come across, even if you are right, you will handle it humbly. You know, even if you're right, but if you're proud and you're bitter, nobody wants to listen to you. Now, righteousness here that is humbled, that is handled meekly, has three fruits. And this will activate in our interaction with others. Firstly, if you're righteous, then you act purely. You will act everything with purity. Blessed are those who are pure. So you cannot act purely if you do not have righteousness in you. You cannot have righteousness in you if you are not humble. You cannot be humble if your soul is still in pain and your spirit is still in control of you, of yourself. So people like others, you know, to be honest. How many of you fall in love with someone who is dishonest, do everything, you know, very dishonestly? You say, oh, I love this person so much because he's so dishonest. Everything he do is not pure. I love this person so much. I want to marry him. How many of us like a person like this? No. We will fall in love and we will gravitate towards those who are honest, who work purely, even though they know what is right and they decide to do what is right, but doing it humbly without being opinionated. That's a difference between opinions and being opinionated. Opinionated means you give your opinions as a demand. You should be doing this because you don't know anything about this. Sharing opinion is all right. Perhaps you want to think about this. I have my opinion to this, but I want you to process this and consider this. So righteousness have three fruits, even though you may know what is right. You are now in Christ, you know, and God has redeemed you with His blood. Then we should be behaving with purity, with honesty, because we know what is right. Second fruit of righteousness is that you must behave with mercy, with mercy. See, the thing is, if I know what is right, but I'm not merciful, then the righteousness is not right anymore. And then you are condemned. And when we begin to talk about others, you know that guy, that pastor, oh, he has an affair. Oh, then we judge. Then we begin to spread that negative news and all that. We begin to, you know, tell others about this. Yes, that person may have done something wrong, and you know what is right, but your action doesn't show that you are merciful. And that's why people, when they have problems, they stop coming to church. Because they know that if I come to church, people will judge me. People will criticize me. People will condemn me. No, that's not what Christians should be doing. In fact, if you have done something wrong, the church is the best place to come, because we will love you, we will forgive you, we will help you to overcome this. That's showing mercy and showing purity. Third fruit of righteousness is that we become peacemakers. Not peacekeepers, but peacemakers. So everywhere we go, we make peace. No matter how bad the person may be, no matter how nasty the person may be, we want to make peace with the person. You cannot be peaceful until you know what is righteous. You cannot be righteous until you are meek and humble, because you're not meek and humble, you know what? You want to win all the time. You want to beat the person down. You know, you're not making peace. Because you're so comparative, you're so combative. You're not meek because your root system here is not right. Yes, as Christians, we know the Bible tells us to behave righteously, to know what is right and what is not right. But to know the idea of righteousness, you know, we need to handle righteousness with meekness, because with meekness, we handle righteousness. With righteousness, we are able to behave purely. You know, the person may be misbehaving. The person may be, you know, doing something that's not right. But we want to restore the person. So we act purely and honestly and tell the person that we love you, you know, and we don't, well, we don't like what you did, but we like you, we love you. And then we want to help you be merciful, and, you know, and stop spreading rumors and gossips. Yeah, and some people say, "Hey, I don't talk about it, but I don't talk." But your fingers do type, check, then and send messages. My mouth never speak, but your fingers speaking, right? And therefore, you have to be a peacemaker. These three are the three fruits. These are the three fruits of righteousness. So if you know what is right, behave right. Because people are observing you. And so you lead by example. Everything, be honest, don't cheat, and don't condemn people, and don't fight with people all the time. Because you know what is right. If you know what is right, then this tree should be your fruits. And people judge you by your fruits, right? This should be your fruit. And if righteousness is not handled by meekness and humility, then, you know, it's maybe because the root system is not yet submitted to God in totality. Maybe there's still part of us that is still in control. So I pray that as we live in this world, there are many people who will observe us because we are on a stage. They will look at us, they will judge us, they will criticize us, or they may like us. And that's why Jesus taught these Beatitudes. It's so that we as Christians, as people who have been bought by the blood of Jesus Christ, and we know what is right, we need to set our foundation right, our root system right. We need to be humble. And then we handle what's right with purity, with mercifulness, and being peaceful. It's not easy, but we can start. We can start. We can start from the basement. We can start from the basement here. Then we can start. Then we can be humble. Then we act what is right. When we act what is right, you know, the three fruits here, that we interact with our environment, that because people will judge us. Others will look at us. Either they will judge us harshly, or they judge us with love. Because we act in purity, we act in mercifulness, we act with as a peacemaker. It's not easy, as I mentioned, but with the strength of God, we can. we can start living with these Beatitudes as found in Matthew chapter 5. I pray that your life will be an example for your children, for your colleagues, for your church people, for your friends who are non-believers, that they will see something different about you. And those things that were different about you is firstly your root system, the poor in spirit. It's no longer your soul that is in control, but God's spirit is in control of your life. Then you live by example that you are humble, even though you know more than others, but you're still humble. Even though you have more things than others materially, you still live a very humble life. And you show your opinions rather than being opinionated. Then when you handle righteousness through purity, through mercifulness, and through by becoming a peacemaker, which is the main objective of what we should be doing, to be peacemakers, not to be troublemakers. Can you imagine Christians as troublemakers? People think that Christian like that, why be Christian, right? So if we want to lead by example, remember the Beatitudes. Lord, I pray for those who are listening here to this message. I pray that God, that this message will resonate in their life, that they will become new creature, new creation as they found you, as they become Christians, Lord. May they bear fruits, may they interact with others, setting an example, just as you have set an example for all of us. Lord, I just pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Puji Tuhan, saudara. Kita sudah diberkati oleh firman Tuhan, oleh hadirat Tuhan dalam ibadah dari awal sampai akhir. Dan saya percaya saudara menyimak semua pengumuman di dalam gereja kita. Puji Tuhan. Kalau ada saudara yang baru bergabung, saya undang saudara, welcome, selamat datang. Dan bisa ikut di dalam acara Connect kita setelah ibadah ini. Puji Tuhan. Senang bertemu semua saudara dan kiranya kita semua setia. Dan kita berdoa firman yang ditabur setiap saat, setiap minggu. Dan saudara bisa buka di website kita, ya, BCS. Saudara bisa lihat di YouTube kita. Saudara terus ikuti semua kegerakan Tuhan melalui gereja kita. Kiranya Tuhan memberkati kita dan saya mau berdoa untuk saudara sekalian. Bapa yang mengasihi umat-Mu, mereka sudah menerima firman-Mu. Kami berdoa semua yang berbeban berat, Tuhan pasti beri kelegaan. Semua mereka yang sedang mencari, mendapatkan sesuatu dalam hidup ini, mereka temukan di dalam Yesus saja. Mereka semua yang sedang bergumul dalam kehidupan, mereka juga akan diterangi oleh Tuhan yang menuntun mereka. Sekarang Tuhan, jamah anak-anak-Mu, urapi pekerjaan, urapi kesehatan, urapi rumah tangganya, keluar masuknya, Tuhan menyertai. Dan sekarang juga memberkati setiap persembahan syukur, persembahan persepuluhan, persembahan untuk misi, pelayanan untuk Asia yang ditabur melalui gereja kami. Tuhan, setiap tangan yang menabur, kembalikan berkat itu berlipat ganda. Karena kami tahu Engkau mengasihi anak-anakmu semuanya. Tuhan, terima kasih. Kami bersyukur untuk semua tim pelayan Tuhan di PCS Family. Tuhan memberkati para pengerja jemaat, guru sekolah minggu, dan anak-anak kami dalam kids ministry kami. Tuhan, luar biasa. Baik, mari kita angkat kedua tangan kita, saudara. Sekarang, terimalah berkat yang utuh sempurna dari Allah Bapa yang mengasihi kita di dalam Yesus Kristus Tuhan kita. Dengan kasih ajaibnya, anugerah dan pertolongannya luar biasa. Dan sekarang penyertaan Allah Roh Kudus menyertai, menuntun saudara, mengurapi sekarang sampai selama-lamanya. Bahkan sampai Dia datang kembali menjemput kita. Katakan, Maranatha, datanglah ya Tuhan Yesus. Kami merindukan-Mu. Semua kita katakan, amin. Amin, amin. Tuhan memberkati saudara. Sampai jumpa lagi. Kasih salam kiri kanan. Haleluya.